It's just been a story of his faithfulness these 25 years. And that's what this 25th anniversary, I think, is all about. It's about how God has been faithful to not just me, but to us and to his promises, to his word, to his church. Well, while I was in my last year of seminary, several brothers called me from this area, and they thought they needed a church in this local area that was going to be solid. The church that was here, the church that Andy Senf was a part of, Steve Shackley and all that, had gotten really small. Sherry and I, we prayed about it for several months, and then we came and we stayed in the Concord Hilton, and we stayed on the top story so we could look out the window and pray. And we were looking over all the surrounding area, not knowing where we'd end up, whether it be Walnut Creek, Concord, Pleasant Hill, what have you.
We were in between churches, so we were discouraged.
And we're jumping around from one church to the other trying to find some decent teaching.
Probably Keith and Lynn maybe shared that. They were visiting our home church, and when we announced that we were going to plant a church, and there they were, inviting us into their homes.
As exciting as these meetings were in our home, and I would say to Keith, but who are these people? They don't know us, and we don't know them. They're like strangers.
Yeah.
And he said, well, we're going to get to know them, and of course we did.
Every meeting was just so lifting and exciting, and you know, everyone would go home, and Lynn and I would just say, I can't believe it. I mean, this is what we've been, you know, thirsting for our whole walk in the Lord.
The day before we opened up in Walnut Creek, there was still a ton of work left to be done on the platform, form, electronics and wood, and we just didn't have the crew to do it. Keith Davis, bless his heart, and others just showed up. People showed up with tool bags and, you know, tool belts and friends of friends they brought.
We completely redid that whole thing. There was mold on the walls when we walked in. And
we were painting. We were just, you know, fixing up the place and doing a lot of things together.
We fixed the roof so it wouldn't leak anymore, and we built a really neat stage.
That Saturday, we finished the platform and we were done. I headed home around 11 p.m. on Saturday night from Walnut Creek. I drove to Fairfield, adrenaline running through me till like 2 or 3 a.m. And then, you know, got up at 5 a.m. and just drove down here so we can get started on that Sunday.
And I went from church to church to church, and to the point it got rather embarrassing. One Sunday I came home after going to I don't know how many churches, and I knelt down by my bed, and with tears streaming down my cheeks, I just cried out to God, God, I am so critical of churches. Please either change my heart or find me a church. Walked into the old Del Valle Library, and there were probably all of 20 or 25 people there, and I thought, this is church? No. Well, I sat down and I listened to Tony's sermon, and that was all it took. I knew God had answered my prayer.
Well, the merger with Christian Fellowship Church was, of course, a big watershed sort of turning point in the early history of this church, for which we're very grateful. George Fox approached me not a month and a half after we started. It was only early December of 95 that he approached me. And Dr. Fox, who I did not know, was the preaching pastor here at Christian Fellowship Church, but his wife, Mamzelle, as many of us know, had suffered a stroke, and she had only recently suffered a stroke. So this was new to him. He called me to lunch, we had lunch, and by the end of the lunch, he offered to merge the church. And I said, that was good Chinese food, but it's not that good. You know, we got to talk about this, George. And we really took actually, you know, another 9 months or so to work through the possibility of merging the congregations.
We were having a ladies' Bible study in our home. One of the women that was in the group was Marge Smith. And she was just telling us how terrific Tony was and how she had grown and how she just loved the fellowship. So I think we came like really quickly. We thought, oh, we're hungry for that.
We found the church to be very friendly. Keith and Lynn Davis were among the first people we met, and they're friends even until today, 25 years later.
And it was just a real, I thought, a real sweet time of seeing leaders growing and people in the congregation encouraging them. And it was everybody working together, I thought. And then when it came time to build the building, it was that again. Everybody just wanted to get the work done, and God was so gracious.
When we had the vision of building a new worship center and tearing down the old fellowship hall that was here, we knew it would cost a good amount of money. We didn't want to do the thermometer on the wall and put it up there and say, you know, we'll raise another $5,000 this month. Where are you folks? Come on. What we're saying is this. Tell the Lord, pray. Would you pray with us this way? That if he gives you something unexpected this coming year, that's what you'll give. Over and beyond your normal giving, you'll give it. You didn't know you were going to have it. He's giving it to you to give to this. And just pray that way. Everyone's like, well, sure. Okay. Well, it was just a few days later, somebody came in the room in my office and said, I need to meet with you. So yeah, sit down. He goes, well, what, it's only been a few weeks. He said, I got a call from, it was a firm he had formerly worked with, didn't realize he had a lot of stock in that company. The stock was sold. He came in, he said, I committed to do this, and here's $1 million. That $1 million came in answer to prayer within a few weeks of this whole project, and it became the foundation of this building. And then God continued to provide that way to the very end, till we paid this place off. We finished this facility, and in essence, this facility was done in answer to prayer like that. So those are some memorable moments, both funny and praiseworthy.
Well, it's a real privilege to greet you on your 25th anniversary. I remember when the church started. In fact, here's something interesting you don't know. When the book Biblical Eldership first came out, Tony was one of the first people to purchase it, and he had me come out to California to visit the church he was laboring in to explain biblical eldership and to work with the church. So I go back a long, long way with your church and with Tony and some of the other brothers. And it's a privilege to be able to greet you 25 years later.
Here's a hope, and that is that we are able to pass the baton on well to the next generation, that there will be a next generation of not only congregants, brothers and sisters that will take this name and preserve this doctrine, which is the gospel, and remain true to it, but there would also be elders and deacons, deaconesses, those who minister on behalf of the church in the next generation. And that next generation needs to be sort of, how we put it, you know, getting on board now, being on board now. The rest of our elders are getting older, so that is a big hope, to see that baton pass well, and that next generation just be a part of this pattern. Of course, we have a lot of good young people in this church, so I hold that hope strongly and believe the Lord will do it.